Hi everyone, thanks for having me here today. It was really my honor to join the event. As the title shows, I want to share some resources with you today that will kindly tell us more about how people read it through the observation of eye movement. And then I will go through more details why we're curious about this. Okay. So in a lot of experimental linguistic studies, many researchers are trying to identify signals that can reflect language users' processing in comprehension or production. And because different technology reflect different characteristics of the process feature and the natures. So, a lot of time researchers will use many different types of techniques like cell-based reading, e.g. eye tracking, fMRI, for example. All these are trying to find out how these joint efforts can help us understand the cognitive process in relation to use of language. But why particularly for eye movement that I'm interested in, because thanks Professor Peng Gang's introduction, ever since I'm in CBS, I'm interested in a lot of different new linguistic studies, but my original training is a synthetician, theoretical synthetician. So I'm curious about how sentences are comprehended. And using eye movement technology, a lot of time researchers assume this, that human readers will fixate on things that we are mentally paying attention to. So it's a way to detect the attention point, attention spent, and the time used on absorbing, processing, understanding this information through our eyes. So since the cognitive process in processing language data has a link that is that processor, the human readers will try to decomposing the information presented to us. And eye movement is one of the technology that is more online, provide movement to movement measures, more timing sensitive, and it allows us to track how readers actually process the information step by step from the text. And a lot of previous studies will use eye movement techniques to study like word sense disambiguation through visual world paradigm, through cell-based reading implementation to study plausibility, dependency parsing, for example, for researchers who are curious about in a longer sentence, how people resolve the scope ambiguation, how do readers resolve the gap filler relations, or like most simple one, which is quite pervasively used in our daily life, is the pronoun resolution. These are all processed covertly and promptly in our daily life, but we learn linguistics, then we know these are not just like very simple mechanism. There are a lot of linguistic layers from the word pronunciation to sentence structure, pragmatics, everything needs to be put together. But tracking the eye movement and understanding the pattern provide us a way to link the process with a more temporal sensitive nature to the information that we are processing. And another interesting questions that arise for what I'm presenting today is when most of the psycholinguists and linguists using eye tracking technology, we use it to observe when certain intervention occurs, how we respond to that, and what kind of measurement would be related to that kind of intervention. But consider reading is quite common, natural for a mature adult reader. This is just like a daily life part of like a trivial thing is that when we open our eyes every day and it start functioning, then a lot of time the readings will not be done by paradigm, not by well-controlled sentence structures, but the same system, the same mechanism is still at work. So I was curious about like what would be reading Chinese language test be like when we are doing in a more natural reading mode. And of course, with the current technology of eye tracking technology, we were able to set up the lab space in a more comfortable setting, although it depends on the experiment session, the time, the duration. But maybe not every participant feel is natural and comfortable, but we already tried, we have a way to make it more natural. But again, if we are looking at specific patterns, specific structure, and like the intervention type of contrast that we, a lot of researchers are curious about, sentences will construct in the very specific way. So if we want to know how readers read in general, we probably also need to find a way to look into text paragraph reading. So that's why this study started. And previously, several studies have mentioned pattern of eye movement during text reading can be influenced also by the readability of text and the type of task requires for reading, in addition to some linguistic fundamental characteristics like word frequency, word length, sentence structure, or like whether the register of the text type. So in this talk, I'll present the data by observing eye movement and then in relation to some measures we propose to help us look into the readability's effect. And I will get to more detail in that in the later part of the talk. Partly related to this is previous study have found that words that are more predictable from previous contexts usually will be skipped during reading, and then it will incur less fixation time. And at the same time, cross-linguistic studies also show that language-specific reading patterns and effects also exist. So not every language would be processed in the identical way. But to do more in-depth study, we probably need more this kind of natural reading data. And recently there are a lot of groups already started. One thing we found is that for Chinese languages, most of the larger database are more available for Mandarin. But with Cantonese data, the resources that are available is relatively restricted. So to start from a small project, I choose the Little Prince project. The reason why we choose this is because actually from a conversation with another colleague that we were thinking about the possibility of doing multiple alignment, and then Little Prince text is having a more colloquial, comprehensible reading, and it has many different versions translated to different languages. So for this, we were thinking about doing this starting from using the Little Prince text with eye movement, so that we will be able to find a way to observe when readers are reading a process of text, what will it be like. So this is the first paragraph from the story. And before I started to look into eye movement studies, I think I don't know how many of you share the same experience, but I initially would think, of course, we read it word by word, line by line, sentence by sentence. But when we do the recording, this is one example from one participant. And we can see that when we are scrolling through a text that it has multi lines, the reading, this actually already considered to be more standard because it starts from the beginning. In many other cases, the first number of fixation might start from the first half of the sentence somewhere. The number here shows the initial parts of the fixation sequence. So this suggests that the reader, when he or she started reading this paragraph, the emphasis, the fixation was on 6 years old first, and then moved to one time, and then jumped to one picture, and then moved to the next line, but then somehow decide to move back to the first line in the middle part to fixate on one book, and then move down to the content of the book, and then further look into the lexical content of the phrase, and then move on. So when this is the case, how can we modulate that? But of course, in order to do that, we need more data. Like one person's reading is insufficient, because I think when I first present you the first pictures, everyone probably is processing it differently. I don't remember what I first processed it now, but I'm sure every time is quite different. That's one thing. And the other is when we compare the text between Mandarin and Cantonese, we assume that Chinese languages are similar. They are, but between these two languages, we also knew that there are some syntactic differences. Before we get to the more in-depth linguistic part, just by looking at on the surface, when we look at the text, I just calculate the first paragraph. It shows that in Mandarin, there are more words used in this version of translation, and it includes 9 sentences to express the content. But in the Cantonese examples, there are 62 characters and 6 sentences. And when we compare them side by side, we can immediately identify several similarities and differences, of course. But then the next question I start to wonder would be like, is the character difference and the sentence difference, such difference cause some reading difference? That's one part of the inquiry that we try to answer and observe from this data collection. So let me briefly summarize the corpus. I call it the version one first, because although I'm quite excited to share this set of data with you and some finding, but this is still an ongoing research. And previously, due to some technical issue and then manpower reasons, we are still in the process of handling all the recordings. But from the text analysis, the first part summarized the text-based information. So in the Mandarin Little Prince, in total, the text that we asked the participants to process have around 300 words, tokens. And then when we calculate by types, it's around 1,000 words types. And the third part for the average number of token per sentence and comparing that with Cantonese, we can see that there start to having some differences occurred. In Mandarin, the average number of tokens is around 12, but in Cantonese is 15. And the range of number of tokens per sentence range from 1 to 42 in Mandarin and then 1 to 46 in Cantonese. The average token length is quite similar. In Mandarin is 1.4, in Cantonese 1.3. So far, we see some small difference, but we can still say that these two text types content are still quite similar. And in this study, in this corpus, we currently analyze 15 participants. We recruit 13, but the overall data that I'm presenting today is only on the 15. And these are the gender and distribution and the average age of the participants for your information. So in addition to the text, the language differences, we're also curious about when the readers were asked to do what to read to extract information in a specific way, as opposed to more natural reading, would they read them differently? Would they read the same type of text differently? And so in the data collection, we manipulate two types of self-paced reading tasks. One is labeled as normal reading, and I will show you the example later. The second type is called text-specific reading, and it's still self-paced manner because we present the items. We basically group all the stories into pages, and then according to the reading task, the reader will read through the paragraph, and then we'll do the task that they are asked to perform. Okay, so I'll show you the example. There's no sound, just a reading process from one of the Cantonese speakers who's asked to read this paragraph through a more normal reading manner. And what it happened is like this. We can see that the participant reads through this line by line and sometimes jump backward to some part of the previous sentences or particularly certain part of words. And then after that paragraph, in this item, it was prompted with a question, a comprehension question. So with normal reading, although we all start from paragraph, but we do not regularly pose comprehension questions, so that we hope that every participant will be still attentive, but try to read it in the more general, natural manner. But to keep them attentive during reading, we randomly show up some content comprehension question like this one. So sometimes a paragraph will be immediately followed by a question, sometimes maybe after two or three paragraphs, then there will be a question prompt for the speaker, for the reader to answer. So this is normal reading condition. And then I will show you the text-specific reading type. So again, we see that the participants was reading the content line by line, word by word on his own pace. And then a question show up. In order to answer the questions, because this format has a question more related directly to the content. And so we saw that the reading pattern actually was slightly different from the normal reading type. To answer this one, the questions we posed were more semantic related, not on specific word directly shown in the content, but on some concept that the speaker, the reader should be able to infer or identify from the text content. So we observed some searching process. And for this type of task, again, not every paragraph has this question, but from time to time, we will post this comprehension question on it, and then the readers will have to answer it. And overall, we check the accuracy rate for these comprehension questions of the two texts. Most of the speakers have it above 70%, and one or two were lower after we exclude them. The participants' accuracy rates are around 80% accuracy. But because this is not really on the intervention type of study, so except for when the reading time and the fixation duration is beyond reasonable, otherwise we keep their study, the result for now, because like previously, many study have shown sometimes there will be individual differences, and we are not sure, like in naturalistic reading type of conditions, how much this kind of individuality effect will show up. So at the current version, we keep everything. And also because these are all undergrad students, we recruit undergrad and postgraduate students, we recruited from PolyU. So we're sure their Chinese is perfect. So it's a matter of how they process this text, how they process the content through these two different reading modes. Okay. After the recording, the most difficult part is, and the exciting part as well, is that there are a lot of information in the recording. Well, previously I showed you the fixation sequence, but that's way more simplified. So here's another example in the text-specific mode. We can see that there are a lot of fixation point, and we'll be showing different reading paths back and forth. Then, so if we want to understand how this part, some text like this, is understood by that particular readers, what kind of features do we need to be extracted from this kind of event? And there are a lot, but in today's presentation, we temporarily considered the following features. These are quite oftenly used and more fundamental. But later, of course, one of the point here is to have more discussion on like what would be other features that can be useful, because we think this corpus should be reusable for many different study purpose. Consider the comprehension process. We were thinking about checking during the reading process, what is the words, each word's omission rate, and what is the sentence skipping rates are like by word base inside the sentence. And then we also tag the text with the part of speech categories, and then we analyze in terms of the part of speech category, what are the rereading rates. And then for the current part, we extract four eye movement measures. The first one is first fixation duration. Usually is related to word information, word understanding. So usually consider this information can provide the first level fundamental understanding of text process. And then we include other measures like second fixation duration. It refers to a word if it was found to be fixated more, after the first time, and then it happened again. What's the duration of that fixation? This process often is considered to be involved with like a word meaning integrating into a larger unit. So as a step beyond the word level, we consider this feature to be able to probably provide us some information how these paragraph informations are built by the readers. And the third one, regression path duration, is again a different measure from the first fixation, because it consider all the fixation paths when a reader read a word and then leave the word and then come back all these fixation pass count, the sum of them, what is effect shows is that it will kindly reflect a larger structural integration information. So we include this one. And then the fourth, total dwell time. This is the overall recording time on the fixation. A lot of time because it's a total time. So the property that it will be associated may be relevant to the word lexical level or partly to the more structural integration level. And it has been found previously that a lot of time adding for considering first fixation duration and total dwelling time, we can cover some of the structural synthetic and as well as the word level information process. But I still consider that adding the other two measures to be more related to higher level process to see if there are some interesting finding. And as I previewed much earlier on, the other part of curiosity is in natural reading, would text complexity influence the way reader read? Previously, most of the study when researchers consider complexity, reading difficulty, or readability, a lot of measures are from like from word frequency, word lengths, sentence lengths. These are, of course, can be extracted as part of the computation. But in this current project, we are also looking for some other new measurements that maybe help us to identify new norms and can help us identify new characteristics that can pin down specific reading characteristics. And from the first one, we consider also graphic neighborhood numbers. By this, for this, we process all the lexical items in each set of text and then run them through two separate word lists. For Cantonese, we use Sifu. It's a frequency lexicon collection for Hong Kong Cantonese. We use this because this word list has more colloquial as well as spoken expression, which containing some words that if you remember in the Cantonese version of Little Prince, they are conversations and those will be used with non-formal word forms in the text. And for the simplified Chinese text, we use internet search of Baidu and Sogou-based lexicon. And then for the others three, these are more synthetic. So we compute the linear dependency distance of a word to the head and the linear dependency distance of a word to the root and the depth of dependency distance of a word to the root as well. So here's one example from a sentence. So for example, if we look at this sentence, we are curious about how to count the distance of one, 一头猛兽. So by this dependency structure, the linear dependency distance to the head of one, because the head is 猛兽, so it will be considered one word away from the head. If we consider the linear dependency distance to the root, here the root is the end of the sentence. And then linearly, we can find that the number one has to cross two other words in order to reach the root node. So in this case, the linear dependency distance will be calculated as two. The third one, the depth of dependency distance, by calculating this, the algorithm will consider the structure of that word inside this large sentence unit. So for here, in order for one, this number to reach the root, it will have to first go to the head through two arc and then the head is a dependent, it is dependent on the verb. So one extra arc, and the verb is linked to the end of the sentence to finish up the sentence. So one extra, so 1, 2, 3, 4. The depth of the dependency distance of the number 1 will be 4. By the number difference, you may notice that there could be some huge difference and some similarity. And there's a reason why we want to consider linear dependency as well as the depth of the dependency distance. If the reading readability is considered structural information's impact, we will expect that the depth will be more highly associated with higher level processing measures result. Otherwise, we probably will be capturing in the correlation. Okay, so these are some general explanation. So we first checked the recording of the two corpus by the word omission rate. Here, the first and second refers to first time reading the text and the second time have the text being processed again. We can see that actually between the two database, the normal reading and text-specific reading patterns are quite similar in terms of whether they are processed first or processed a second time. And there's not much difference between the Mandarin and the Cantonese speakers. These are observatory plots just plot by individual participants' results, but the general pattern is the same and the range of the omission rates are quite close. And then we also check the sentence skipping rate. Again, I guess because we set up the comprehension questions quite properly, so it doesn't matter whether it's the speaker is asked to perform natural reading or text-specific reading, they actually tend to process the text carefully, but also in a similar way. So simply by looking at the skipping rate and omission rate, the difference between the reading modes are not very different. But we can see that the text-specific readings have a slightly higher skipping rate. We thought it might be because when they already see the questions on the same page, they can quickly just jump to the relevant part rather than going through all the words. So that might be something we can infer on. And then we also check for the part of speech categories, what's the average rereading rate. And here is a further simplified part of speech category. So in the database, in the formal publication form, we're thinking to provide a more detailed, comprehensive part of speech tagging because sometimes more subtle category, for example, for nouns, for verbs, may be useful for other research purpose. But just to observe what's the general tendency between the Cantonese and Mandarin data. Here I present the result with a more concise, simplified sets of part of speech category. And then we can see that when the in general, when readers are asked to process the text for the first time, the reading rates tend to be higher on the content words, and some exceptions are like the mark here is for interjection words. But then when the same texts were presented to them in the second time, the rereading rate dropped a lot, and mostly on the like adjective, adverbs, or the verbs, or still having the reread proportion obtained. Okay, now the second part of the features previously, I shared that we proposed to look into these four features that we think could be related to complexity, text complexity. And just by the basic, for the base situation, in the Mandarin situation, the text shows that the average orthographic neighbor numbers per word is 372, and Cantonese is around 150. Here we see a lot of a huge number gap, and I think it's also a reasonable difference because consider that Mandarin simplified Chinese version has a lot of one-to-many mapping of a word, whereas the traditional characters has less, fewer such cases. So that suggests that in the simplified Chinese text, the words can be more ambiguous in context, independent of context, but sometimes they're in context. So the word can be more ambiguous, but the words in Cantonese will be slightly less ambiguous. Consider the average linear dependency distance of a word to its head. Mandarin is 2.9, and then Cantonese is 3.4. The average linear dependency distance of a word to its sentence root in Mandarin is around 8.8, and then Cantonese is 15.9. I want to pause a little bit here because the number here shows that the linear dependency distance of a word to its root suggests that it seems that Cantonese has a longer sentence. More words in the sentence. But if you recall that in the previous summary of the text in general, the average token and the average sentence length between Mandarin and Cantonese are not that different. So here it may suggest that the structure of Cantonese text is more dense compared to the Mandarin text that we study in this project. Although both of them should be considered more casual colloquial because in this story, there are a lot of conversation and a lot of description in the more daily life register. Okay, the last one, average depth of dependency distance of a word to its sentence root. The two sets are quite similar. In Mandarin is 2.2 and then in Cantonese 2.4. I take that suggesting that these two texts actually do not have very complex sentence structure in the text. Okay. But what's interesting is that this lexical ambiguity difference between Mandarin and Cantonese and the potentially structural difference between the Mandarin and Cantonese shown by the linear dependency distance of a word to the root seems to suggest that there may be some difference shown for Mandarin and Cantonese reading. And because we only have a small set of data from the 15 participants over this 3,000 words process, we run a correlation analysis. And then on the upper left corner, we have the linear dependency to the root, linear dependency to the head, and then the depth to the root, and then the neighborhood numbers. And then from left to right is the same for the two sets. We have the first fixation duration, second fixation duration, regression past duration, and the total reading time. And the number is very small, but simply by looking at the distribution of the dark and lighter shaded colors, we can already see that there's some difference between Cantonese and Mandarin in terms of the four features that we consider would be related to text readability with the four eye movement measurements. And particularly in Cantonese, the linear distance to the head, the linear distance to the root are more correlated with regression and dwell time when they are asked to do the naturalistic reading. And in the text-specific reading, there are more measures that are more correlated. So here for the depths, distant to the root is related higher to with the first fixation duration. And then again, with the other linear measurements, is related to more correlated with the regression path duration. But these kind of patterns is not found in the Mandarin data set. And what's interesting is that the more obvious correlation seems to be on the neighborhood numbers with the total reading time. And then one of the different one is the linear dependence of the word to the root correlate with the regression path duration when the speakers were asked to do natural reading. So this distribution of the correlation pattern kind of reflect what we just summarized from the basic difference between the two texts. Okay, due to the time. And so I want to talk about what would be the future application. Again, what I present today is just a database. And then I hope that in the future, if we add some more interesting annotation, and then we can think of a way to align to different types of linguistics or like processing information to this eye tracking feature measurements, we probably can do a lot of different prediction and to do prediction test. For one example is to do a computational type of modeling in addition to psycholinguistic modeling that try to modulate the cognitive process. The other change is some researchers also believe that if we can create a cognitively proper computational model, these kind of models should be able to make similar decisions as humans do when we process text. And to check if this is correct, we can compare the patterns of machines and of human beings, how they make decisions, how they share, how they pose their attention. So one trend that's recently quite popular is that language models prediction of human processing pattern in signals, not only just eye tracking signal, it can also be on fMRI or EEG, other type of signals that can identify different human language process stages. So the question to be answered would be, can language model accurately model human behaviors in language processing? So one related aspect I'm also curious would be like, for example, in Professor Tsai's study, there's a plausibility differences. We said data, if we can train the language model, can the computers use these models to do the similar identification? Okay. And but in order to do that, we have this database, for example, but we need to consider what features can influence. And if we are able to identify the features that actually can influence the readability or what specific type a level that of the linguistics that will drive the readability differences, this would be another way to help us understanding the reading process in general. But to identify the proper feature is one thing. And then if we identify useful features, can we train the language models to see if they also rely on similar sets of features for readability? But at the same time, there are also some other points I think worth considering. I don't have answers for now, but one is that individual differences have been found to be quite critical in many different domains, not only just on sentence reading or on normally developed mature adult readers. Many different groups will have different individual performance differently. How do we capture that is another potential direction. And in our data, we found that although the overall pattern of each individual speakers is the same, but there are still some slight difference with respect to whether they treat the first time reading and the second time reading of the text in the same way or differently, or like they are just very careful reader or very quick reader, so there's no distinction between the normal reading or text specific reading. So these are some other things we can consider. And the next one about more text domain, again, in this one, we are curious about what is natural reading in Chinese languages would be like. But we, of course, do not just read casual reading for leisure time. And a lot of time we read difficult technical text. So would that require different reading pattern behaviors? That's the other thing that we can work on. But of course, we need to take a joint effort to expand the project. And then the last one is if we have a lot of multilingual resources like this, then we can do multilingual comparison or multilingual prediction. Here I indicate the CNPL this year has a shared task. CNPL is a cognitive modeling and computational linguistics. This year in summer, they have the workshop. We actually, some of us joined the shared task. In that shared task, we were asked to use eye tracking features of the sentence from six different languages and then see if we can come up with a system that can predict more accurately for this language data. The six languages are Chinese, Dutch, English, German, Hindi, and Russian. So from this list, you can have some ideas that they are very different languages. And then how can we do that? How can we do that? In this shared task, the four eye tracking measurements are the first fixation duration and the total reading time and the standard deviation of these two, only these four. For our system, we consider some more language-specific features, but our features are more lexical-based, like a word frequency, word length, whether the language used a capitalization or uppercase in the language in the text or not. And we also check a syllable count. What I want to say is that when we use this features to create a system, a regression system to predict the eye tracking, eye movement patterns across these six languages, our system actually did very well. But there's some difference in our finding is that our system predict the first fixation better than the total reading time. So in our paper, we summarized that we thought it could be because the feature that we consider are more lexical driven, like word frequency, word the index of the word in the sentence, the word position. So these information are more related to lexicon. But and therefore it seems to be predicting the first fixation duration better. Well, it still did well, but not as good when it's the system is asked to predict the total reading time. So we were thinking that maybe this could be one of the reasons that we should develop and find some more features related to the higher level text structure so that we can improve the system and can gain new knowledge in general. Okay, thank you very much for today. And here's some, of course I have to thank the following members from Chinese and Bilingual Studies, this is a big project and we're just started. And of course, without them, I cannot actually share the initial finding with you today. So I want to thank them and also thank all the audience today. Questions, suggestions, comments are of course welcome. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank Professor Xu for her sharing. Let's now turn to our audience for any questions and comments.
Thank you very much for your talk. And I wonder whether in your database you will consider, for example, like the predictability from the context, for example, the word predictability. For example, nowadays as a computation models, actually we can compute the entropy or lexical surprise or some kind of this kind of parameters use some kind of computational modeling and for the test. So I wonder whether you will consider these parameters in include these parameters into your database, because I think that because you also mentioned that the total reading time actually is not quite well predict less predicted by the logical features. But what about some kind of contextual features such as the predictability? I think they may predict some kind of also predict both some kind of eye movement measures. Yeah, and that's my comment and question. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I actually cannot see you, but for the predictability, what kind of predictable feature do you have in mind? It's true that in addition to what I present today, there are other features we want to compute and extract and match together in the later stage. But of course, if you have some specific idea about what you mean by predictability, because there could be from different input.
What I mean by predictability, for example, actually we make predictions all the time in the test, right? So we can make the lexical predictions for the words from the previous context, right? Yeah. So actually we have this kind of knowledge. So actually nowadays the computational models can compute using some computational modeling, we can compute the entropy, right? For example, uncertainty for the words. So I wonder this kind of parameters can be incorporated into your database, and because I think this is a very important, because nowadays we always prediction actually is a very hot topic in language processing, and so I just wonder that this kind of parameters will you consider incorporating into your database?
Yes, we will. and it's computable, so right. But yeah, we will add that in, and then because the next stage will be like using this kind of data, can we do like a language identification, language classification?
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So any more questions? Okay, it's almost a time. Okay, now if no more questions, let's thank Professor again for his sharing. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.